This is the Off the Beaten Path podcast with Ben Merritt. And you won't be hearing any of that here.
Who that be then?
Looking for a good time, man, it's been a week. We got a little bit of money, it's enough to make us funny to the girls that we gon' meet. We were cool and full beach bound lawns, just sitting down, sand between our toes. We made a toast to the summer, gonna pour me another, man, you know how it goes. Yeah, well, it's a Friday night and we're feeling right, and the girls, they look their best. We got the golden gray and the guitar swaying. Hits you right. Yeah, find a cute little thing, raise your glass with me and throw it back. Woo! To Friday night. Yeah, we drove around downtown, raising hell, getting loud, thinking we're all that. We did a whole lot of kissing and not a lot of missing. Hey girl, give me back my hat. She said, come with me, and boy, you can see, but I'ma wear this thing all night. Grab your boys, bring an awful lot of boys, cause tonight we're doing it right. Yeah, well, it's a Friday night and we're feeling right, and the girls, they look their best. We got the golden gray and the guitar swinging, in fact, we ain't gonna rest. Well, if you worked all week, throw back your feet and let the good times hit you right. Yeah, find a cute little thing, raise your glass with me and throw it back. They look their best. We got the golden gray and the guitar twang. In fact, we ain't gonna rest. We need to work all week, throw back your feet and let the good times hit you right. You find a cute little thing, go and grab another drink, raise whatever you got and take a shot. To Friday night. Here's to Friday.
Off the Beaten Path podcast with me, Ben Merritts. That's Jared Payne and his tune Friday Night. That's actually his debut single. Jared released an EP back in 2012 called The Backroads. Definitely a great EP to check out. Earned him actually some songwriter's abilities. He is currently writing for Fever Pitch Music Publishing Company. They're located in Greensboro, North Carolina, and Jared hailing from Columbia, South Carolina. It's not a very long commute, but he probably would wish to move to Nashville sometime soon. And who knows, he's currently working on his debut album and plans to release it in the fall of 2014. I hope to get him on the old podcast. Jared Payne, if you're listening, man, come on, man. Ben Merritt here for Off the Beaten Path podcast. Thanks for hanging out with me, and thanks for diving in to a little bit of that country music that maybe you were just a little timid to go out and buy the single. Maybe you're a little timid to go out and buy the album or the EP. But I'm giving you that taste. I'm giving you just that little bit where you're like, okay, that was a really good song. I really like them. I'm going to do it. I'm going to dive in. I'm going to become a fan. So that's what I'm trying to do here, folks. I'm trying to broaden your country music horizons, and I'm doing it one song at a time. Coming up later on in the episode, Marshall Dane going to stop by. He and I kind of had to work around some technical difficulties to get in to, well, You'll hear it all. We'll explain a lot of it, and I'll even probably talk about it later on in the episode. So stick around, though, because Marshall is definitely worth it. Another woman that is very much worth it, and you've probably heard her on some developing her chops on country music radio, but she's got great music across the board. Leah Turner, she is the daughter of a rodeo champion. She said that the very first time that she can remember listening to great music was on the road to a rodeo. She was listening to Garth Brooks, Chris LeDoux, George Strait, Trisha Yearwood, and it just kind of developed into a love for music. Story has it that she was first found sitting at her grandmother's piano at the age of 3. They bought her a piano at 5, and by 6, she wrote her first song. By the way, she still owns that piano that her family bought her when she was 5 years old. Here it is. This is her brand new tune. Again, you're going to be hearing this one on Country Music Radio here pretty quickly, I'm sure. This one's called Pull Me Back. It's Leah Turner on Off the Beaten Path podcast.
Feels like there's miles and miles between us in this bed. We're lying back to back, a half inch from the edge. I feel you reach across my legs. I wanna wake up, make up, but I'm not ready yet. Here when I push you away.
It's Off the Beaten Path podcast with me, Ben Merritt.
Cover band in some college town bar. get you through. Just a sad song playing on the radio station. Tears still falling, heart still breaking, 'cause you're hanging on. Or is it a love song about someone new? What are you listening to? You're just like me, trying to figure out how a good thing goes bad. I don't know, and I can't let it go. Yeah, it's about to drive me mad. What are you listening to? Is it a cover band in some college town bar? Something to get you through. Just a sad song playing on the radio station. Tears still falling, heart still breaking, 'cause you're hanging on. Or is it a love song about someone new? What do you listen to? Is it a cover band in some college town bar where it's 999 and guitar? Is it something to get you through? Just a sad song playing on a radio station. Tears still falling, heart still breaking, 'cause you're hanging on. Or is it a love song about someone new? What are you listening to? I put that record on. Girl, you know what's on. And I let it play again and again.
Off the Beaten Path podcast with me, Baden Maritz. There is Chris Stapleton. And what are you listening to? Chris has been around music for a very long time. As a matter of fact, he joined his first band, the Steel Drivers, back in 2008. Won a couple of Grammys. Well, he was nominated for the Grammys. Sorry, didn't mean to say won. But including Best Country Performance by a Duo or Group. So there you go. Stuck around with the Steel Drivers for a while. He left in early 2010 to join his own and create his own rock group called the Johnson Brothers. And then in 2013, he signed on with Mercury Nashville as a solo artist and put out What Are You Listening To on July 1st. So July 1st, 2013, he's just about coming up on a year on that one, and it's a top 50 hit for him. So looking forward to some brand new stuff from Chris Stapleton in the very, very near future. Ben Merritt taking you all the way up until you're fully informed and fully educated on some brand new out there kind of country music. And in this duo, this block, you know, Chris Stapleton into the gentleman slash group that I'm going to go into, very bluesy, very soulful, very kind of alt country, but that's fine. I love it. I hope you love it. Chris Stapleton, and now it's the Chris Weaver Band. I've played Chris Weaver Band before. This will be their second album. Standing in Line was the name of the first album and the name of the first single. This is actually the second single off of their second album. It is also the title track. The first single off the album was called Raise the Dead. Now we've got American Dreamer. Again, like I said, it's the title track. And Chris Weaver goes to say that Standing in Line opened a lot of doors for him, and American Dreamer is more him and the band. This is what they will sound like on a regular basis. It's very bluesy, very soulful, and it's very good. Here we go. It's Off the Beaten Path Podcast. Chris Weaver Band, An American Dreamer. Podcast.
He's my husband. You just don't know it yet.
Come on. With me, Ben Merritt. Like us on Facebook at facebook.com/offthebeatenpath. Off the Beaten Path Podcast with me, Ben Merritt. And I am on the line with a man that I am going to go ahead and say is much more resilient than I am, and definitely much more of a road warrior than me. Marshall Dane. Marshall, how are you, sir?
I'm doing great, man. Thanks for having me on the show.
Definitely. And we're going to get into that story in a little bit, because this is actually the second time that I've tried to talk to Marshall in the last week. Yeah? Or it was earlier the last week that we tried to talk, right?
Yeah, man.
All right. So we'll get into the story why that time didn't work out and the subsequent story of that. But first, Marshall, we have to go through the icebreaker questions. You've been through these ones before, so they're not going to surprise you at all. Question number
one. If the answers are the same.
All right. See, he already knows. Question number one. Where are you right now? Be as specific or non-specific as you would like.
Okay. Well, I remember the last time I talked to you, I was in my jeans, but I was on the top bunk of a train going through the west coast of Canada. This time, I'm in a pair of tearaways, and I'm sitting on my stationary bike with a tee in my hand, working out my right leg that I tore the ACL at Calgary Stampede last year. I still need to do rehab for it, so I'm sitting here talking to you and stretching my leg.
There you go. Those ACL injuries, they take a while to recover from. So,
yeah, just me and the rest of the Olympic athletes, yeah, same thing.
I know quite a few country artists that do it on stage. There was I believe John Party had an ACL tear just a couple months ago as well. So, you know, it's a pretty common musician thing. Active up there on the stage, you never know.
Yeah.
So there you go. All right. See, Marshall answered both questions because he's heard them both already. So, tearaway pants though. You didn't go with the vinyl leopard print like we talked about.
Leopard print vinyl. No.
No. All right.
Not to pull that out for this interview.
All right. So I got Marshall Dane on the line. Marshall, again, we tried to talk like a week ago, but, you know, you were going through the Rockies. You were coming back from Saskatchewan, right? You were in Saskatoon.
I was, yes.
So you were on a train, which is a very viable means of transportation in Canada, usually. But we were having some cell phone issues, so we decided to reschedule for later on. And, it was a good thing that we rescheduled for a later date as opposed to the earlier date that we could have because, well, it turns out your train was delayed for a little while, and you want to tell us why that is?
Sure. I mean, I really wish it hadn't delayed at all. And we had ended up, when we stopped in Winnipeg, just after Saskatoon, just after I spoke to you, mm-hmm. We were already 2 hours late. We were supposed to be in Winnipeg by 8:30 at night on whatever day that was last week.
Yeah.
And we didn't end up there till I think close to 1:30 in the morning, so we were already a couple of, you know, 3-4 hours behind. And then we ended up having a piece of one of the cars got hit by some ice or some debris on the track. That stopped us for a couple hours, but the big one was a few hours later, we had derailed the front, or I guess whatever place the engine's at. I don't know if it's the front or the back, but the main engine of the train actually skipped off the tracks and was damaged to the point of not working anymore, and the train came to an abrupt stop, and we stuck around for another couple hours. They had to jerry-rig it a bit and then try and take it back to we had to backwards travel 4 kilometers so we could drop this piece of engine off somewhere in the middle of nowhere on a track, and then we took off with a slower, tiny secondary engine. And, delayed us by upwards of 15 hours. And
wow.
Everybody was really happy about that, especially me.
I can only imagine. Yeah, you're doing a big Canadian radio tour. You're up in Saskatoon. You're ready to head on home to Southern Ontario. And I don't know if I want to be on a train for 15 extra hours that I'm supposed to be. So
it was an exciting journey. It was an interesting event. I mean, it was all fine. Everybody was healthy, safe, and sound.
Yeah.
It was more of an inconvenience than anything else. And it's just one of those things that when you're an indie artist, you know, you sit there and you think, how are we going to do this? Instead of taking the easier route, which is hopping on a plane and flying back home, we thought, well, let's take the train. Let's make some new fans and friends along the way.
Yeah.
You know, we'll blog our story. And as it turned out, at one point, we had lost reception between Rogers and Bell Canada and anybody else on the train that had a cell phone. Nobody had reception for almost 72 hours. It was quite ridiculous. I've never heard of that, but we made it, and we still blog stuff, you know, via video, and we'll post it a little later on. But we had a great time, and we made some great friends and great fans. So it was it was worth it in the end. But it was a tough haul, boy.
Wow. Well, that just goes to show you, traveling by train in northern Canada in mid to late March is probably not the best way to do it anymore.
Yeah, note to self. Hindsight is 2020.
All right. Well, now that we're caught up on what you're doing lately, let's get to know you as an indie country artist. Marshall, country music, man, it's kind of taken over Canada lately, hasn't it?
It's, it's kind of taken over the world ever since it started going into this kind of rock country kind of phase. I mean, at one point it was pop country with the Shania Twains. And then with the Jason Aldeans, it started turning into more rock country. And you know, Canada's got its own blend of country, traditional country music, and its own blend of rock music. So when you start putting it together with, you know, both those genres together, you know, we once again have our own little version of Canadian country rock. And, you know, there's a lot of artists out there that, especially in Canada, that have got that kind of rock background, but, you know, we're still a northern country, and we're still a, you know, a lot of remote places out here. So there, you know, the country love or that country feeling is strong out here. So it's nice to have the blends, and that's kind of what we do. That's kind of what, you know, everybody's got their own little version of it, but that's where it's at. That's what our stuff is.
So would you say that, you know, growing up, you grew up on a little bit of country? You know, did your folks play country, listen to country, anything like that?
Yeah, my folks were definitely not, they weren't your typical, you know, 60s, 70s child. They were definitely into more, I mean, as far as, you know, they weren't into the hippie scene. They weren't into the rock and roll vibes of the 70s and 80s. They were into the softer sounds. My mother, you know, loved the softest kind of music. So she'd like, she would like, you know, Zamfir and Glen Campbell and, you know, Simon Garfunkel. But my father, not a rocker, although he did love Elvis Presley, he was always a country guy. He was always Willie Nelson, Garth Brooks, Merle Haggard, Conway Twitty, that kind of stuff. And it was great. I mean, I loved that background. My grandmother was a huge country fan. And when I look back, I don't think about them as being country fans per se, because we didn't really see, you know, genre specific. It was just all good music kind of thing coming out of my folks. So I definitely had a strong root in the folk country background, you know, even before I was, that was what was starting to influence me even before I started to play music.
All right. Well, I mean, that's a pretty solid foundation to be raised on and kind of, you know, grow your own roots in the country genre as well.
Yeah, man.
Definitely.
I mean, I spent a bunch of time trying to do anything that came to my mind as far as songwriting or recording. If I felt like hearing banjos and African chanting, I put them in the same song. You know, it was never anything specific, but then everybody was always asking me, what kind of music do you call this? I'm like, I don't know. It's just a blend of whatever pops in my head. So
yeah,
for me to eventually end up, when I started going to radio for the first time, that's when I realized, oh, they have to put you in a specific spot. And
yeah.
I didn't know where my stuff sat. So just by making music and putting it out there, the audience and the people around me, you know, kind of made the decision that, oh, you know where this fits is right here in country. You know, it's on the rock side of it, but it's right here.
Definitely.
So it was great to finally have a little place that they could find a home for me.
Well, I mean, country is a one-loving kind of a genre, you know. We'll accept a little bit of everybody. So that's definitely a good place for you, I think.
Yeah, man. Oh, it's perfect. It's beautiful. It's a great community to be involved with. And it wasn't, I mean, as soon as I went to my first Canadian Country Music Awards back in 2008, I knew within 10 minutes of being there that these were my people and this was my kind of community that I wanted to, you know, pursue my musical career in.
Definitely. Well, I'm glad that glad to have you there, Marshall. We appreciate you.
Right on.
There you go. All right. So, question now. You're not new to country music. I mean, as you said, you've been to the Canadian Country Music Awards, and this isn't your first album either.
No, I've got a record that I put out in 2010, which was my first full-length album, major record.
Mm-hmm.
And that album was what helped launch me into being able to talk to you right now and have all kinds of awesome shows with guys like Alan Jackson or getting calls to open up for Reba McEntire, which the most exciting thing for me about when I get those phone calls is calling my parents and saying, Dad, can you believe this? You'll never guess who I just got asked to open up for.
Is that when they go, well, I guess you've made it then, huh?
You know, it was funny. My mom, not too long ago, when I told her I signed into a new little record deal, and I mean, the deal was, you know, pretty much just enough to kind of take care of the record and anything record related only.
Right.
But my mom made the cute joke. She goes, "Can I start looking through the catalog and start picking stuff out?" I'm like, not quite yet, Ma. Not quite yet.
Nah.
Don't look for a new leather couch or a house with a swimming pool. Just give me a few more. Give me a couple of days on that.
I'll get back to you by the end of the month, though. How about that?
Yeah.
All right.
I'll figure out rent, Mob, but otherwise, yeah, I'll help you out.
Nice. All right. Well, sir, let's take a listen to a track, shall we? The title track. How about that one? One of These Days. Tell us a little bit about that one.
Sure, man. That song was written in July of 2011. It was my first writing trip leading up to, or it was my first writing trip to start writing for this new album that I didn't know how I was going to afford. I didn't know when I was going to release it, how it was going to come about. I didn't have a record deal at the time. And even now, I mean, I'm still considered indie based on the type of deal I have. And, you know, and I thought, well, how am I going to do this? And it was, I had just been on my first big tour ever in 2011. I'd never been on a big bus, you know, being the opening act for a bigger band. And all these exciting things, and yet I found myself not being able to take any time to stop and smell the roses. So One of These Days was written out of me needing to get something off my chest, which was basically, don't wait any longer to take advantage of the day. Don't wait any longer to take advantage of the beauty that life is, because it's fleeting and it's fast and it goes by real quick. And if you don't grab it right now, you're going to sit there and think, why did I always just say someday I was going to do this? And now it's too late. Now I can't do it. And that's how the first line starts in the song. It's like, girl, we always say someday when it comes to leaving this town. You know, pack your suitcase, it's getting late. I don't want to wait anymore. Let's get out of here. And so it's meant to be an empowering song, uplifting. It's fun to drive to because it makes you feel good and smile. And I think that's what we got out of One of These Days.
Well, there you go. That's a, those are pretty heavy words and definitely a great theme to be doing a country tune to. So we'll take a listen to it. We'll come back, talk about the new album, talk about more about Marshall Dane, and less about that harrowing train trip of yours, all right?
All right.
Come on, girl. Girl, we always say someday when it comes to leaving this town. It's always off in the future. It never seems to come around. I've got a few dollars saved up, and I've got the windows rolled down. I've got a tank full of dreams, and they're telling me there's no better time than now. This is one of these days.
Baby, this is our chance.
So there we go. That's the title track from Mr. Marshall Dane. That's One of These Days. Marshall, how are you, sir?
I'm still rocking and rolling, baby.
All right, then. And still sitting on the exercise bike, right? Or no?
I've moved from the exercise bike, and now I have my face planted against the window in my bedroom so that I can ensure the best possible quality of reception that you can have so your listeners get all of me instead of a jargled version of me.
Well, so far you sound crystal clear, sir. So
beauty.
There you go. All right. Well, Marshall, again, the new album is One of These Days. And tell us a little bit about the album writing process. Maybe tell us a little bit about, you know, what went into the new album, things like that.
Sure. This album, as I was saying with One of These Days, the first tracks were written, One of These Days and Forever Girl, in July of 2011. And then up until the summer, I guess, of 2012, we had made the decision process of, we had about 54 songs collected to be windled it down to make 12 songs on this new album. And it was a great process. It was a different process. I had a different producer than I had previously had. And, I mean, I'm always open arms to those kind of things. I like having new players and new people to work with. I mean, there's so many great people in this business that it's nice to kind of spread your wings and get different people's feels. So we had a different crew of band players in. And, you know, it was exciting. It was a bigger studio than I'd ever worked in before. And it was just a great process. I was there for every step of the way. It was a lot of fun. We have great tunes like Take You Home to Mama and I'll Be Your Whiskey. And, of course, our latest single that just came out is Alcohol Abuse, One of These Days. It's just got a real high-energy, crispy, clear, you know, fresh, modern sound. It was a lot of fun to make. There was a lot of laughs. And when it came for the slow tunes, we turned the lights down low, and I'd take a few minutes and just get my head into the right space and then, you know, bust out a vocal for, you know, a more depth, more emotionally charged song. So it was a great process. It was smooth, and every day I had to drive 2 hours outside of my city to go to the studio. So as opposed to the previous record, it was like 15 minutes up the road. So there was definitely the kind of challenges that you have to kind of just get through in order to make, you know, an album happen. It's, you know, it's not always as easy as, you know, Rihanna, where you can just fly in everybody from across the planet and they come to you.
Or other artists who have their own recording studios in their basement or something like that.
Right. There's those too. I was talking to somebody the other day about Greg Allman, and I'm like, yeah, I think his studio is probably a little better than mine.
probably, yeah.
Right? You know, he probably has a couple of guys. Like, just before Quincy Jones gets there or somebody else shows up, you know, I think he probably has a few guys tweaking the sound.
Yeah, probably. He's got a couple of professionals on retainer, yeah.
Right. So, but, yeah, no, it's, yeah, no, it was a great process. And, you know, we do what we had to do, and we came out with a great second album, I think.
Definitely. And I enjoyed listening to it. I've heard it. And it's, as you said, it's a lot of high energy, a lot of fun. It's definitely one of those ones that you can really get pumped up listening to. It's a lot of fun.
Right on, man. Thanks, brother.
All right. Well, now it's down to the gratuitous pimping yourself. It's literally the pimp yourself portion of the program. And this is your chance, Marshall, to turn fans into super fans and turn casual fans into super fans as well. So it's pimp yourself. Tell us how they can get in touch on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. I don't know if there's a Canadian version of Instagram. Is there a different? I don't think there's a different version.
Yeah, Instagram.ca.
There's a lot of maple syrup and some back bacon.
Yeah, if you go to maplesyrup.com/Marshall Dane, you might just find me.
There you go.
So other than the maplesyrup.ca/Marshall Dane, you can find me online, pretty much anything online, /Marshall Dane. We've kind of taken over the whole /Marshall Dane concept. So if you go to facebook.com, it's /Marshall Dane Music. If you're on Reverb Nation or Twitter, it's just twitter.com/Marshall Dane. The easiest way to find anything that's going on with my music is if you go straight to my website, marshalldane.com, which is marshalldane.com. We've got little emblems there that you can click on, the Twitter or the Reverb Nation or the Facebook or the iTunes or Amazon, whichever format that you use to get your music. We have access to it, or you can do all of it directly from the site. You can watch videos from the site. You can listen to music from the site. You can read up on our Twitter account and stuff like that on the site. And you can also purchase CDs directly from the site, which I would sign myself and then mail out to you. So we've got it all covered. And if you can't find us, worst case scenario, just go to Google and Google Marshall Dane, and you'll see probably some old funny pictures of me and then all the new stuff.
There you go. And continuing on with your big radio tour, I'm sure, so they'll hear more about that. And, yeah, it's just Marshall's a very busy guy, that's for sure.
We don't stop. We just shot a video for our latest single, Alcohol Abuse, on March 16th. Then we left on early on the 18th for our Western radio tour. We'll probably be leaving Ontario somewhere around the 23rd of April to go on a U.S. radio tour. And then we'll be back in Ontario for May 3rd for shows out here. And then, of course, the summer festival season will be starting to go, and we will be busy yet again. I don't even know if I'll ever take a vacation.
Hey, your job is like a vacation sometimes when it's not derailed trains and cell phone troubles and, yeah.
Oh, it's a vacation, all right.
Definitely. All right. Well, Marshall.
Permanent vacation.
Marshall, tell us a little bit about the new single. You had said that you got the new video out there. Tell us about Alcohol Abuse.
Alcohol Abuse is another example of, you know, my kind of sense of humor. My kind of tongue-in-cheek way of, you know, turning a frown upside down. We've got songs like Love and Alcohol and I'll Be Your Whiskey and Lynchburg is Dry. You know, funny songs that relate to alcohol. And in this case, it's no different. Alcohol abuse is not about drunken debauchery. That's not our game. But it is about spilling drinks. And it's funny to me when, you know, you work in the clubs in order to make your way through the musical, you know, levels. You see some of the funny things and, you know, whether it be, you know, some guy that said something he should not have said, and now he can see his girlfriend is clearly angry with him, to, you know, in this case, alcohol abuse is all about, you know, people when they're bouncing around on the dance floor, they don't realize there's somebody behind them. So when they go and they throw that beach ball up in the air, but their elbow knocks somebody's margarita over.
Oh no.
You know, and margaritas are sticky and all that kind of stuff.
Oh yeah.
We made a big, funny video that reflects the funny, high energy of the song. I can't wait for people to see the video because I think the song itself, without the video, is awesome and a lot of fun and fun to dance to and fun to yell out alcohol abuse at the club. But when you see the video, which we'll have posted in the next week and a half, you'll get a real clear understanding of how far our little sense of humor goes. Yeah, it's a lot of fun. We try and take life lightly and you know, as serious as it has to be at times, you know, there's always got to be a little bit of comic relief, and I'm here to provide that.
Oh, most definitely. All right. Well, Marshall, I appreciate the time that you've given me, sir, over the couple of days that we have attempted to do this interview, and thankfully we were able to sit down and get some time together, and I appreciate it, sir.
Hey, brother, it's my pleasure, and, you know, thank you very much for your patience with our scheduling, because sometimes that's just how it is when you're on the road. It's, you know, you got to take it one day at a time, and sometimes one phone call at a time. But, you know, I'd like to thank your listeners and yourself for, you know, having us out here and supporting our indie music project.
Definitely. Marshall, again, I appreciate your music. You're doing just fine, sir, and hopefully you'll pick up a few extra ears from the podcast, all right?
Hey, thanks. Thank you kindly, man.
Alcohol abuse, shameful waste of precious booze.
Hit the chicken wire in front of my face. Jack Daniels was falling like a rain on the stage. Then a fight broke down and a bouncer broke a bottle. Over all that noise, I heard somebody holler, alcohol abuse, shameful waste of precious booze. Name your pain, whatever you choose. Oh, highball, Bloody Mary, fuzzy
navel, cooking sherry, mudslide, margarita, whiskey sour, straight tequila, screwdriver, hurricane, Shirley Temple down the drain. Every drop we lose is alcohol abuse. Well, the trouble escalated as the cops showed up. They busted through the doors, pulled out their handcuffs. Said, boys, you need some help, a little rehabilitation. We're running you in for misappropriation. Alcohol abuse. Shameful way. Still, Samuel Adams gone to hell. Every drop we lose is alcohol abuse. Hey, yeah, yeah. Watch it. Here we come now. Oh, alcohol abuse. Shameful. Fuzzy navel, cooking sherry, mudslide, margarita, whiskey sour, straight tequila, screwdriver, hurricane, Shirley Temple down the drain. Every drop we lose is alcohol abuse. Michelob Band, Heiser, Miller Lite, Budweiser, Newcastle, Harpoon, Lone Star, Blue Moon, Dos Equis, Amstel, Samuel Adams, Gone to Hell, Highball, Bloody Mary, Fuzzy Navel, Cookin' Sherry, Mudslide, Margarita, Whiskey Sour, Straight Tequila, Screwdriver, Hurricane, Shirley Temple, down the drain. With every drop we lose, it's alcohol abuse. Every drop we lose, every drop we lose is alcohol abuse.
Off the Beaten Path Podcast with me, Ben Merritt. Follow us on Twitter at OTBP Podcast.
We're 90 miles an hour down Bowater Road. Way too fast to know where to go. I was singing to you, you were looking at me. Well, the Hiawassee River ain't as big as you'd think. I could see my whole world sitting there on the bank. And it was you, girl. It's always been you. Well, the only thing that mattered that night was the stars in your eyes and the campfire light. Old guitar for you and pulled out a jar of my homebrew, and next thing I knew I was singing to with you. That's why we go on. I was on the edge of giving up. Outside that old pawn shop, smiled and said to me, take your daddy's five string guitar, play another one for me.
Off the Beaten Path podcast, me, Ben Merritt, and there is Zach Dillon and Derailed, D-railed, that is on the line, Bowater Road. And Zach is an accomplished young artist. Zach is about 21 years old now, but in 2009, when he was 16, he impressed Roger Dean Miller, producer, to work with him and kind of push him through the world as a country music artist. So impressed him enough at the age of 16. That was only after a handful of guitar lessons that started when he was 14 years old, too. Holy cow. I'm looking forward to hearing a lot more from Zach Dillon. He's going out on the road here pretty soon. As a matter of fact, November of last year, he got to open up for Florida Georgia Line. So, hey, Zach Dillon's off to a good start. Ben Merritt, again, trying to teach you a little bit about brand new up-and-coming country artists, maybe some of those artists that you've never heard of before, but now you are. Thanks to Marshall Dane for stopping by. Marshall, that was a lot of work to try and get that interview, but it was definitely worth it. Marshall is a great guy. I had a lot of fun talking to him. All right, stick around. We've still got one more for you. As a matter of fact, we got another one for you. Here's Carrie and Billy. Carrie and Billy both come from, like, very different backgrounds. Carrie was in a family band growing up in Minnesota. She's from Minnesota. She's played violin since she was 7, by the way. She plays that thing like it's breathing to her. So, but Billy, he came from Tampa, Florida, hunting, fishing, playing sports, basically developed a love for country music through his family. And, now they're together and they just sound fantastic. So here's Carrie and Billy right now. Are you ready for the weekend? It's Off the Beaten Path podcast with me, Ben Merritt.
You ready for the weekend? What do you say we just sleep in? Pull the sheet over our head and not get out of that bed till noon. Maybe you could throw a few things in a sack. We'll pick a place that suits whatever you pack. It don't matter where we go. Baby, all I know is if I guide you, I'll do anything or nothing at all. We can roll around the world or just sit out on that porch. Yeah, baby, let's go crazy, and for a while we'll leave it all behind. Let's see where Sunday ends. Are you ready for the weekend? Throw a tent out in the yard, lay on a blanket, and look up at the stars, and watch the Milky Way ride our names across that endless sky. We've got a weekend, we don't have to do a thing, but just say the word, we'll jump the next outbound lane. Baby, I don't care, I'll go anywhere as long as I got. Go crazy, and for a while we'll leave it all behind. Let's see where
we can roll around the world. Just put your hand in mine.
I'll do anything or nothing at all. We can roll around the world or just sit out on that porch. Yeah, baby, let's go crazy. And for a while we'll leave it all behind. Let's see where Sunday ends. Are you ready for the weekend? Are you ready for the weekend? Girl, I'm ready for the weekend.
It's Off the Beaten Path Podcast with me, Ben Merritt. Like us on Facebook at facebook.com/offthebeatenpath.
They warned you well that I ain't no good. I've been around a time or two. I put you through hell. I'll just lay you down. And maybe I was born to run in the forever setting sun. That was me then. Old habits I'm meant to break. And this is me now. I shouldn't have run. I was the one who should have tried. Run till the end. I'll chase you till it breaks my heart. I ain't gonna stop. Too far, over the edge, falling too hard. This time around, won't stop loving you. And I know that I let you down, but that was me then, and this is me now. I should've.
Off the Beaten Path Podcast with me, Ben Merritt, and there is Marianne Allison, Until It Breaks My Heart. Marianne actually started her career, and I say a career, completely different than she started her music career, because Marianne was actually a successful CPA. She was a certified public accountant, and then just decided that it was a life of music is what she desired, and man, am I glad that she decided to do that. So there you go, Marianne Allison And that's Mary with an I. M-A-R-I-A-N-N-E. Allison. So there you go. Ben Merritt, taking you all the way up until right about now, actually. I'm out of here. This is the last little bit of this episode, at least. Join me next week as we talk to Joe Bachman. Joe Bachman, he's a guy that shares a couple of favorite hobbies with me. So I'm excited to have you guys hear that interview. I don't know why I went, but I liked it. Joe Bachman going to be on next week. Thank you to Marshall Dane for stopping by for this week's episode. And thank you for stopping by for this week's episode. Stay in touch. Email me, otbppodcast@gmail.com. Get on the Facebooks, Off the Beaten Path Podcast, and on Twitter, @OTBPPodcast. And keep in touch. Spread the word. Spread the love. Tell your friends and family and coworkers and random people on the street about the podcast. And tell me about your favorite band, maybe if you feel like they're not getting enough love, you know? All right. That's going to do it. Have yourself a good one. Joe Bachman next week. Ben Merritts. Thanks for joining me. It's Off the Beaten Path Podcast.